Let's stand as we pray. Holy Father, thank you for what you have done for us, Lord. And as we worship you today, send us the Holy Spirit that we can worship you as you have instructed us to worship you, in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's continue standing as we sing hymn number 469, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
I believe in God, even when God is silent. It's an extraordinarily testimony of faith under extreme circumstances. Good morning, guys. Nice to be here with you this morning. I remember reading this study a couple of weeks ago, which basically proved that when two people or more are eating the same thing, they come to agreement quicker. Isn't that interesting? So they did tests. They had a couple of people eating a different meal than each other, and another couple of people eating the same food. And when you're eating the same thing as someone else, you come to unity and harmony quicker than you would otherwise. I thought that was interesting. Now the reason, you're probably thinking, why am I telling you this? The reason is I think probably the same might be true when we say the same thing together. And so that's exactly what we're going to do now. As one church body, we're going to stand, if you would, you can stand with me, and we're going to say the same words and to try and be in harmony and unity together. So you'll find what we're going to say on the screens on either side of me or on your church bulletin. So let's read together in harmony our church mission statement for this season. We consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus our Lord, for whose sake we have lost all things. We consider them worthless that we may gain Christ and be found in Him. We want to know Christ, to know the power of His resurrection and participation in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, and so attaining of the dead. Amen. And so because we want to know Christ and we also need to know each other, we now have some time for us to do that because we are a body, the members need to know each other. So walk around, mingle, get to know someone maybe you haven't met before. And I'm actually going to give you a question to ask each other. Why don't you ask each other, where did you see God at work in your life this week? So discuss that amongst each other. Where did you see God at work in your life this week?
Money and I'm going to be able to eat today and I'm so excited. Anyway, while they were passing by, he asked somebody, what is happening? And you know what they said? They said, Jesus is passing by. And you know what he thought? He thought, Jesus, I've heard of him. I've heard about him. He performs miracles. I've heard that he gives sight to the blind and that he makes the lame walk. And he thought to himself, maybe Jesus can heal me. Maybe he can give my sight back. So you know what he did? He shouted. He said, Jesus! And Jesus kept walking by. He didn't hear him the first time. So he shouted even louder. He said, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And do you know what happened? Jesus turned around. And he walked over to him. And I'm going to change a little of the language. He said, how can I help you? And the man said, I want to see again. And Jesus said, your faith has made you well. He believed in Jesus. And so he got to see it again. Isn't that amazing? And when we see Jesus and when we hear Jesus, he can make us whole again. Isn't that amazing? All right, who would like to pray for us today? Expal. Okay, you ready?
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day.
Amen. Thank you, Expal. You guys have a wonderful Sabbath. I think there's children's worship today, so you may go to children's worship.
Thank you.
As the choir is coming down, if anybody has any special needs or requests for God, if you want to make your way forward at this time, we will go ahead and sing our prayer song, hymn number 671.
I always have to speak and be at Praxis Church, the young adult thing that we have going over there in the chapel, which means I only get to speak here and be here, you know, once every couple of months, which is a shame because I really, really enjoy being with you. So it's great to be here, honestly, and I love having this opportunity to try and share God's word with you as best I can. But I also get very nervous when I speak here, and this is the reason why, because I get nervous because of the combined years of wisdom that are in this room right now. Last night I got out my calculator and I thought, well, when I preach at Praxis, you know, let's say the average age is about 25 years old, and we have about 35 people going. So if you multiply that together, you get 875 years of combined wisdom in that congregation. And I thought, wow, that's pretty high, 870 years of wisdom. But then I did the same calculation for here, and I thought, well, maybe let's say the average age here is perhaps something like 45. And I think on average we have about 400 people coming. So I multiplied those numbers together, and it's 18,000. So, you know, I thought to myself, I really have to step my game up and make sure that my sermon is really on point, because there's a lot of wisdom and intelligence in this room today. Now, of course, I'm kind of messing around, but on a serious note, I know that Pastors Mike and Shane have been working with you guys for the last few weeks, talking about these messages, really about these one-on-one encounters with Jesus. If you've been here for the last 3 weeks, you'll know what I'm talking about. First, we had Jesus in the wilderness with the devil, right? You remember that? And then I think a couple of weeks ago, it was Jesus meeting Nicodemus. And then last week, you had that story about Jesus meeting the woman at the well. And so today, we have the same kind of thing, another personal encounter with Jesus. And this time it is this very long passage. We won't be able to read the whole thing, but it's with Jesus meeting this man who has been blind since birth. So let's get straight into the passage. As I say, we can't read the whole thing because it's about 41 verses, but we're going to read the first part now. The words will be on the screen. Just listen as I read the first part of this story. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "No, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He has been born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, this is very strange now, right? He spat on the ground, made mud with the saliva, and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. Amen. So let's stop there. We'll pick up the passage a little bit later, but for now, what's going on? Well, as you can see there, when the disciples come across this blind man, their immediate response is to ask, well, what was his sin? What terrible things has this guy done in his life to deserve this terrible punishment of being blind? Or Jesus, is this inherited sin? Maybe he's blind because his parents did something really bad. Now, you've got to remember, this was a real belief. At these times, people believed that even a pregnant woman going into a pagan temple, even the fetus inside her would have been guilty of idolatry. All right, so this idea of inherited sin was really commonplace. And sometimes we might think that that's really old and archaic and pre-modern and we don't believe things like that. But I think actually many of us do mistakenly still believe that if we're suffering, we must have done something wrong in our lives to deserve it. I remember visiting this woman once in hospital, suffering from cancer a few years before she passed. And she asked me, Pastor, what have I done wrong to deserve this? Why is God punishing me? And of course, this passage was perfect. I reminded her of Jesus' words. This man is not sick because of a sin he or anyone else has committed. Good and bad things happen to good and bad people. That's kind of just the way the world works. But here's what Jesus goes on to say, which I think is really important. He says, this man's blindness is an opportunity for God to display his healing powers. If something is wrong in the world, it becomes a chance for Jesus to fix things. So of course, Jesus urgently addresses this blind man's situation, because Jesus' sole purpose on this earth is to bring light into situations of human darkness. Now, if you know the Gospel of John at all, you'll know that John loves to talk about Jesus as light. Okay, this metaphor of Jesus as light. Think about the beginning of John's Gospel. He says, in him was life, and that life was the light of all humankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And of course, even outside of John, in the rest of the Bible, think of the very first words in Genesis that we ever hear God utter as he brings the world into existence. What does God say? Let there be light. So throughout the whole Bible, we have this symbol of light, God's very presence creating new life, bringing brightness to those dark, empty spaces. So I'm going to ask you now, and just be honest with yourself and just contemplate with me, what are the dark areas of your life right now? We know that we all have them. Are you in a dark financial situation or with employment? What would it mean for God's light to come in and break through to you? Maybe you're too attached to money, too attached to your possessions. What would it mean for God's light to break through to you? Are you in the middle of a family feud, or are you in the middle of an end of a relationship? Are you struggling with addiction? Are you struggling with lust or other bad habits? Are you tired? Are you depressed? Are you broken from feelings of guilt and shame about your past? Well, above all, Jesus asks that you just let his light break in to those dark places. Now, what Jesus is offering physically to this blind man, Jesus is offering the same spiritually to all of us, right? Jesus is offering light. It's why we sing in the hymn Amazing Grace, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Not because we're physically blind, but because without Christ's light, we'll always be stuck walking around in circles, walking around blindfolded, walking around in spiritual darkness. Now this idea of light, if you think about it, here's the interesting thing about light. You can't actually see light, can you? If I asked you to describe light, I mean, what would you say? You can't really describe light. But the way light works is actually far more interesting. Light helps you see everything else in the world properly. C.S. Lewis captured this idea marvelously. He said, "I believe in Christ like I believe in the sunrise. Not because I see it, but because by it I see everything else." So Jesus is the light through which we see everything else clearly in our lives. Does that make sense? Another strange metaphor, but I think it works, is, you know, imagine a dog running up to the front here, coming into our service, and the dog would see the same things that we see. The dog would see the pulpit, the flowers, the piano, the organ. It would see all of you guys, right? But the dog couldn't interpret the data. We would have to give the dog human eyes in order for the dog to see properly. Likewise, God needs to give us spiritual eyes in order for us to interpret our lives properly. So you want to know what type of parent you should be? You want to know what type of son or daughter you need to be? You want to know how to use your money? You want to know how to act in your marriage? You want to know how to treat the planet? How to treat animals? How to treat your enemies? How you should help the poor? The light of Christ is meant to give us proper vision in all of those areas. It is a light that helps us to make sense out of our whole existence. So as we continue in this story, think about your journey with God. Think about your experience that you've already had with Christ. I want you to reflect on those moments in your life, right? Reflect on those moments when Christ gave you light. Those intimate encounters you had with him that led you to prayer, that led you to your baptism, the time Christ saved you and transformed you. Reflect on when he changed your heart and gave you the power to forgive and love and show mercy and compassion. Now, in my opinion, there's only one thing in this story that makes this blind guy such a hero of the faith, and that is this. He acknowledges Jesus as his Lord, and he recognizes the work of God in his life. Do you recognize the work of Jesus in your life? Now, what happens? Jesus takes some of his own saliva, mixes it with mud on the ground, makes like a paste, I suppose, and smears it onto the man's eyes. Now, interestingly, the symbol here is the mixing of Christ's divinity and Christ's humanity. That is the only thing that can save. Christ, the person who is God and man, is the only person who can heal this blind guy. And then the man runs to the local pool, a big pool that would have been outside of the temple, in the temple courtyard. This big pool, about 200 meters long, imagine it, with steps going down on every side. A pool that people would use to clean themselves before they entered the temple. Jesus tells this man, "Go, wash your eyes in the pool." What's the symbol of the pool? Well, it's the symbol of baptism for us, being cleaned and purified by Christ. That's kind of the end of where we read to, right? And it's a happy ending. And we would think, yeah, everything's great. Not quite. And I encourage you, when you go home or sometime during this week, read the rest of the story, but I'll kind of tell you what happens. When we read on, we see that not everyone wants to celebrate this man's being able to see. There are three objectors, okay? First of all, his friends. People come up to this guy's friends and they say, "Oh, is this the same guy that used to be blind?" And most of them say, no, it can't be him. It just looks like him. It's not the same guy. And then the Pharisees get really mad. Why? Because the healing took place on the Sabbath. And their logic is, you know, that if anyone dares to heal on the Sabbath, if anyone does work on the Sabbath, then obviously, you know, obviously this Jesus guy can't really be from God. I mean, they say, well, Jesus has 6 days in which he can heal. This man's blindness isn't urgent. Why doesn't Jesus just heal him tomorrow? And then, really, really sad, tragically, the man's own parents won't admit that Jesus has healed him. Why? Because if they do, they know that the Jewish leaders will kick them out of the synagogue. So his parents just shrug their shoulders and say, well, we know our son's been healed, but we don't know who did it. And of course, they do know who did it. But they just say, oh, just, we don't know who did it. Ask him yourself. He's old enough. Ask him. So guys, what's the fundamental problem in this story, right? What is the sin that this story is warning us about? It's our inability to recognize the light-giving power of Christ in our lives. Let me say that one more time. This is the sin this story is talking about. Our inability, our refusal to recognize the light-giving power of Christ in our lives. And it's, as I thought about these three groups of people, of the friends, of the Pharisees, of the parents, I think these three groups represent perfectly all of the obstacles, all of the things that get in our way of recognizing God's work. What do I mean by that? Well, the friends who don't believe. Quite simply, think again, thinking about your own conversion, your own experience with God, some people just won't believe that you've changed. Some people have decided that you don't deserve conversion. Some people will remember your past and they'll judge you for it forever. They don't believe that you are someone that Jesus would waste his time with. And unfortunately, I always find that happens to me when I go back to England. All my friends remember the old me, and they just can't accept the fact that Jesus changed my life and Jesus, you know, made me a pastor. They can't accept that. They say, no, no, you're not the same guy. And I don't know if you guys have ever heard the same kind of thing in your life. You aren't someone who can change. You're always going to be the same person. You're not good enough. I'm telling you, don't believe it. If you know that Jesus has encountered you, if you know that Jesus has transformed you, don't ever let anyone take that fact away from you, okay? And secondly, don't think like a Pharisee. Don't look for religious reasons to discount your experience with Jesus. The Pharisees are so quick to dismiss this blind man's conversion as wrong, as evil, as something that could never be from God. Why? Simply because it doesn't fit with their idea of how God ought to work. So they refuse to celebrate with the blind man simply because they're caught up in convention. They're stuck in tradition, too blind to see the good that Christ was doing. So if you experience Jesus in a different way than from what you expected, if you experience Jesus in a way that's different from others, don't dismiss it, right? If your conversion experience is different from my conversion experience, doesn't mean that you're wrong, okay? Say that again. If you get converted in a way that he or she or me didn't get converted, that's okay. Doesn't mean it's wrong. If it's good, if it heals you, if it gives you light, it's from God, okay? Simple as that. Third, and maybe most unnerving, expect your faith to shake up your world. Encountering Jesus will dramatically affect your life. Why do I say that? Well, the blind man, you know what he can expect from this? He can expect rejection, marginalization, and excommunication. I don't know if you guys knew this, but synagogue leaders would, depending on the sin you'd committed or the offense you'd committed, synagogue leaders would expel you from the community from up to 2 days to 10 years, sometimes for life. And as we saw, really tragically, even his parents are willing to have their son thrown out of the community while they save themselves, effectively making him an orphan. That's extreme, right? But the point is that publicly recognizing Jesus may mean that you lose friends. It may mean that you get ridiculed and mocked and insulted. It may even mean that you get kicked out of church. And that's exactly what happens to this blind man. But he doesn't mind because he has Christ. And let's read now the end of that passage. So if we have on the screen verse 35 to 39, this is what happens after the blind guy has basically been kicked out of the community, after he's been rejected by his friends, by the Pharisees, and by his own parents. He comes back to Jesus. Well, Jesus heard they had driven him out. And when he found him, Jesus said to him, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And the blind man answered, "Well, who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." And Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshipped him. And Jesus said, and this is really the summary of everything here, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." It's a very poignant ending, isn't it? The man who sees for the first time in his life is totally ready to give up everything and worship Jesus as his Lord and Savior and healer. All this man knows is he was once blind and now he can see. Not only does he have his physical sight back, but now he has spiritual eyes to recognize that Jesus is the one who did it. No matter what he has lost as a consequence of his faith, he now belongs to Jesus' community. He now is a part of Jesus' family. Guys, the sacrifices that you make for Christ will always be worth it. So as we're in this season, leading up to Easter, right, we're all in this season of reflection and praying and fasting. I think that today's scripture is perfect. So I encourage you always to open your spiritual eyes. Open your spiritual eyes so that you may see Jesus at work. When you go through your day, don't just view everything through the lens of skepticism. Don't try and explain all those miracles that happen. Don't explain them away as coincidence or chance. That's always the choice we have, right? We can rush around in the dark, blindfolded, too busy to notice that Jesus is present in every conversation, in every interaction, in every thought that we have. Or we can let the light break in, and we can live our lives with gratitude. We can live with clear vision, courageous enough to interpret every moment of our lives as an experience with the living Jesus. So let's not be blind to the work of God. Reflect on everything he has already done in your life, and let the radiant beams of his light illuminate you. Amen.
Church, please stand with me and sing our closing hymn together. Hymn number 108, Amazing Grace. Lord, you truly are the light of the world. We thank you so much for shining brightly in our lives and always illuminating those dark spaces. May we go now, may we reflect that light into this world. In the name of your precious Son, Jesus. Amen.